Hello and welcome to the presentation on Dynamics of Machinery, Unit Number 1, Single Degrees of Freedom Systems. So up till now, in the last class, we have seen the contents like the fundamentals of vibration, elements of vibrating system, and vector representation of simple harmonic motion along with the degrees of freedom. So in this presentation, we will see what are the different types of vibrations, equivalent stiffness and damping, and if possible then we'll see the introduction to the physical and mathematical modeling of the vibrating systems, for example the bicycle, motorbike or quarter car. So the first type of vibration will be based on the degrees of freedom. So we can classify the mechanical vibration as follows. First is the single degree of freedom systems, 2 degree of freedom systems, okay, then 3 degree of freedom system, or a multi-degree of freedom system, and the fourth is a continuous system or the systems with infinite degree of freedom like this particular cantilever beam. Second type of vibration is classified based on the excitation force that is present or not. So in some systems there is no excitation force present, so that is called as free vibration, and when there is a excitation force is present, that is called as forced vibration. So free vibration example is like a simple pendulum is there, to which you are not having any external excitation continuously being supplied there, while in case of any automobile there is a diesel engine or petrol engine which is providing the excitation force. So similarly there is a another classification of the vibration based on the external resistance that is present or absent. So if external resistance is there, that is called as damped vibration, and if it is having no external resistance to the motion of a body, it is called as undamped vibrations. So let us discuss in detail what exactly is the free vibrations. So for a system said to be in a free vibration, if it is, it does not contain damping elements and no time varying external force acts on the system, so that is called as free vibrations. So a system is set into vibrations by some initial disturbance, that means you are providing some initial energy input which can be expressed in terms of initial velocities and initial displacements of the various masses. So this energy remains constant all the time, and hence the system keeps on vibrating indefinitely. That means if we try to obtain the variation of this particular type of system vibration, so you will get a continuously this kind of vibrations over there. So there is no decrement in the amplitude of vibration with respect to time, it will be continuous. So though one of the none of the real systems can execute free vibrations, study of the free vibration is very important because the behavior of a system gives clear idea of how the system will respond to forces acting on it. Because every real system will be having certain resistance to its motion, and therefore its vibrations will completely damp down at the end. But for understanding and the behavior of the system, this is the assumption that free vibrations are there. Now next is the damped free vibration. So when system contains damping elements but no time varying external force acts on it, so the motion again due to some initial disturbance is called free damped vibrations. Since the damper dissipates energy, the system will come to standstill after some time. So this study is important for shock response analysis. In this case, the vibrations of a system, suppose initially it may be having large amplitude of vibration, but finally it will be decreasing and it will completely dissipate. So this is what is nothing but called as damped free vibrations. Now next is a force vibration. So when the system is excited by time varying external forces, it undergoes force vibrations. For example, any automobile, it is being provided with a prime mover, that is generally an engine. So engine provides a continuous excitation force which causes the vibrations in the system. Or here in this case, machine is there to which you are providing electric motor as an input, so it is also providing some vibrations. So in case of force vibration, the system may be damped or it may be undamped system. So when there is resistance, it is called as damped, and when there is no resistance to the motion, it is undamped. So and the excitation also will be a periodic one or it may be a random one. So periodic forces can be split into simple harmonic functions through the Fourier series. So generally we consider that there is a periodic forces if it is there, so then we can understand and analyze that particular force vibration properly. So here are some examples, like there is some external forcing function which is F0 cos of omega t. This is the particular force externally acting over it, and it is a periodic force which is causing the motion of this particular system. Similarly, sometimes there is a base excitation problem. That means when the vehicle is moving on a road, so or a plane is landing, so landing gears will experience this kind of base excitation force, so that time vibrations will occur in the system. Or there may be some rotor excitation, that may be for a centrifugal pump or the reciprocating compressors and all. So those systems will be producing some excitation forces. So because of that, the system will start vibrating under the force vibration. The next type of vibrations are based on the mathematical model. So sometimes we consider the linear variation of the system components. Like if I consider the linear spring, so it will be having the variation like this. A straight line will be there, exactly straight line. While if it is a non-linear one, in that case the spring may have variation of this stiffness like this. Means if it is considered as a force over here, and if it is considered as a deflection over here. Same time, some models are deterministic vibrations. Means deterministic vibrations means nothing but a periodic vibration which we can expect. Means it will be repeating after itself. And the random vibrations means a periodic vibration. So in this case, the vibrations occur very randomly, and there may be so many impacts in between, and some transients will occur. So that's what is called as the random vibrations. So in total, the vibration is basically divided into linear and the non-linear. So in case of linear, there is single degree of freedom, multi degree of freedom, and distributed mass or infinite degree of freedom. So this is what we have seen the classification of it. Then single degree of freedom, under that it will be free vibrations. So free vibrations is also under the multi degree of freedom and distributed mass also. Then there is a damped free vibrations. So damping is there, but vibrations is a free vibration. There is no external force. So it is also under the single degree, multi degree, and this infinite degree of freedom systems. And there is a force vibration also. Also it is coming under all these categories, like under distributed mass also there is a force vibration, multi degree of freedom, force vibration, single degree of freedom, also there is a force vibrations. And then these force vibrations actually being classified as a periodic forces, then base excitation, and random vibrations. Okay, so with this introduction of the vibrations, now we will talk about the so now we will see how you can get the equivalent stiffness and equivalent damping. So let us consider initially, suppose if there are two springs in series connected like this. So there is some mass attached at the end of this particular spring. So definitely because of this mass, this particular spring will get deflected. And you will find observe here that when a mass is acting at the end of this particular spring K2, like it is specified the K1 as the stiffness of the spring and K2 is the stiffness of the another spring. So this mass will get deflected by some deflection, that is delta. So as the stiffness of these two springs will be different, so definitely the deflection of this spring K1 will be delta 1 and deflection of this spring K2 will be delta 2. So the total deflection which will be there of this mass will be the sum of deflection of the spring 1 and spring 2. Since because of the different stiffnesses, these two springs have different deflections. So we can write this as one equation. So delta will be equal to delta 1 plus delta 2. And now we have to convert this system of two springs into a system with a single spring. So here we have to get the equivalent stiffness KE, and the mass will remain as it is. So in general, stiffness is nothing but equal to force per unit deflection, so F by delta, and the force is nothing but K into delta. So if I have to put the value of delta into this particular equation, so delta will be equal to F by K, or F by K I can write. Now Second thing is that the same force is acting over this spring K1 and K2, and therefore this force is equal to m into g, so mass and the gravitational acceleration. So same will be acting on the F1 and same is F2, so forces are same, and therefore when we write this delta is equal to F by K in this equation number 1, so I will write this delta means for the equivalent spring will be equal to F by K, that is equal to for delta 1 F1 by K1 and for delta 2 F2 by K2. So definitely here I will observe that F1 is equal to F2 is equal to F, so this F term will get cancelled out. So I will be getting finally 1 by KE is equal to 1 upon K1 plus 1 upon K2. So this is nothing but the way you can calculate the equivalent stiffness for two springs in series. Similarly, if there are two springs in parallel like this and there is a mass attached at the bottom, so the force over here again it will be M into G, and the stiffness of the spring K1 and of the spring it is K2. So there will be deflection delta 1 of this and delta 2 of this, but here as these two are in parallel, so definitely deflection delta 1 and delta 2 will be equal, deflection is same. So whatever the deflection of this K1 is there, same is of the K2 and same is of the mass, so delta will be equal to delta 1 is equal to delta 2. And in this case now the force is shared by these two springs differently, so whatever the capacity of this spring is there, that much force will be shared by this, and depending upon the capacity of this spring it will be sharing the force. So total force is equal to F1 plus F2, so total force will be equivalent spring stiffness multiplied by delta if I convert this system into an equivalent system. Now these two springs in parallel can be like this will be represented, or it can be represented like this also, because if I pull this particular mass downward, so whatever is the compression of the lower spring is there, that much is the tension in this spring. Okay, and while in this case both the springs are having the same extension or contraction. So for equivalent spring now I can write KE into delta is equal to K1 into delta 1 plus K2 into delta 2, as the value of F1 is equal to K1 delta 1 and value of F2 is K2 delta 2. So in this case I will observe that delta 1, delta 2 and delta, all these three quantities are equal. So this can be cancelled out from this equation, so remaining is equivalent spring stiffness, that is equal to K1 plus K2. Same thing is applicable in case of dampers in series. So if there are two dampers in series having capacity C1 and C2 as damping coefficients, so C equivalent will be equal to 1 by C, that is equal to 1 upon C1 plus 1 upon C2. Similarly, dampers in parallel, so two dampers in parallel like C1 and C2 in parallel in this case, so we will get the equivalent C for parallel dampers, so C is equal to C1 plus C2. So after this we will see the introduction to physical and mathematical modeling of vibrating systems. So basically we are doing it to represent all the features of a system for deriving mathematical model or analytical equations governing the behavior of the system. An elementary model is created to get quick understanding of overall behavior of the system. So it is developed by adding more components to observe its behavior more closely. So initially we can have a minimum number of components which will be giving us just an overall idea about the system, and then to predict the exact behavior of the system we can add it now more number of components and we can make it a more complex. So when we are putting it when a minimum number of components it will be called a single degree of freedom system, and when you add the more number of components it is called as multi degree of freedom system. So this is what we are going to see in the next presentation. So thank you very much.